So let us start. See, first of all, our population is continuously increasing, isn't it? And the traditional methods of farming, they cannot bring about so much of increase in crop production that can meet the growing demands of our country. So it is continuously a challenge to the farmers or to the agriculturists that how they can increase the crop yield. So they have tried various techniques or strategies to improve the crop yield or improve the plants, okay, so that they can become more useful to us or useful to the mankind. And these strategies together is termed as plant breeding. So what is plant breeding then? So plant breeding means any technique that will alter the genetic makeup or genotype of a plant so that it can become more useful to us or can have some desired character. Alright, say higher crop yield or higher disease resistance, anything that will make it more suitable for growing. Okay, so this method of plant breeding, it has been continuously being employed from around 9,000 to 11,000 years ago. So man have been trying continuously so that plants can be more under our utilization. Bringing some plants or bringing any organism under human management, that is what is known as domestication. So due to plant breeding, by continuously, you know, altering or manipulating the genetic makeup of a plant, we have been continuously domesticating the plant. Yeah, you heard me right. You might be thinking that only animals are domesticated, right? No, even for plants, if you bring a plant under human management, that will be termed as a domesticated plant. So today at present, whatever plants you see all around you, especially the crop plants that you're using, that you're eating, all those plants, they are all domesticated varieties. The natural plant which had evolved, that is known as the wild relative. And for most of the crop plants, the wild relative have already become extinct. You cannot even find it throughout the world because we have kept on putting emphasis on the domesticated varieties. And because we had kept on, you know, manipulating and we had kept on using the domesticated ones, the wild relative eventually would of course become extinct. So that's how we have kept on domesticating the plants, but the natural characters of the plant, the natural traits of the plant, they have somehow been lost. Alright? So in this class or in this chapter, we are mainly going to discuss about plant breeding. So we'll be discussing all the strategies that have been or that can be employed to improve a crop plant. Okay? So now, there are various methods of plant breeding, okay? There are some age-old methods which are known as classical method of plant breeding. Like one of the methods you have learned already, that is artificial hybridization, isn't it? By artificial hybridization, you make two plants cross, and by making the artificial cross, you try to bring some desired combination of traits or characters in the hybrid. Right? So that's a classical method of plant breeding. Likewise, today, due to so many advanced technologies that have come up, like genetics or molecular biology, it has advanced so much, isn't it? Today, plant breeding is done in a much more advanced manner by using some molecular tools. But even then, the conventional method of plant breeding is mostly employed by most of the government institutes or companies. Okay, so we'll start our discussion today with the conventional method of plant breeding, and let us see what are the steps which will be required to do so. Alright, so let's start. So the steps to develop new variety of crops by the age-old conventional method of plant breeding. Alright, first, collection of germplasm. I just now told you that the first plant that evolved is called the wild relative, and eventually we kept on manipulating it and we have kept on differing its genotype to give rise to various varieties of that plant, right? And today we have the latest domesticated variety, right? So germplasm means collection of the seeds of all those plants, starting from the wild relative to up till today, the most advanced variety that we have of that species, say wheat. So wild relative of wheat, and up till today, whatever varieties of wheat has been formed so far by plant breeding, all the plants, if we take together and we collect seeds from all of those plants, then we can call it to be the germplasm of that plant. So usually germplasm collection means we are collecting all the diverse alleles of all the genes that may be present in a single species. So what are alleles, what are genes, you will get to learn again under genetics. Okay, but right now you just try to understand that wild relative is the first plant that evolved, and we have kept on altering its genotype or altering its genetic makeup so that it becomes much more useful to us. So we have kept on making many varieties, right? So starting from that wild relative up till now, whatever varieties have been formed so far, if you collect seeds from all these plants, then the collection of seed together can be termed as germplasm of that species or of that plant. Understood that? So first thing you need to do is collection of germplasm. Alright. Now, after you have collected the germplasm, next thing what you do is you now need to sow all those seeds and let those seeds grow up to become plants. After the seeds successfully grow up to become plants, you now have plants of various varieties of species. Say in my example, I have taken wheat. So you suppose have 1,000 varieties of wheat now with you, right? Now you have to evaluation and selection of parents from among those plants. Now say from those variety of plants, one plant is disease resistant, another plant has higher yield, another plant shows tolerance to water stress, another plant is insect resistant. Likewise, different varieties have different types of pros and cons, right? But you now, you are doing this whole method. Why are you doing it? To produce a new variety, right? So you must be having your own demand. Suppose you are wanting to create a variety of a plant which will show disease resistant and high yield, both. Alright. So of course then, among those thousands of plants which have different types of characters, you would be now, choosing from all those plants which are going to behave as parents or parental generation. From among those plants, you will have to choose two plants. One should have disease resistant, another should have higher yield, right? That's what is called evaluation and selection of parents, right? Among all those varieties from the germplasm, you will successfully have to take a lot of time and properly evaluate the characteristics of all those plants. And from out of those plants, you have to choose two plants. These two plants will behave as parents in your experiment further. So you will have to mark those plants as male and female. Anyone you will have to mark as male. Another one has to be the female. Now, after you have marked the parents, that means you have marked one plant to be a male and another to be a female, the next thing that you have to do is cross hybridization among the selected parents. So cross hybridization means the artificial hybridization that you have already, that has been already discussed. It mainly had two steps. One is emasculation, another is bagging, isn't it? In emasculation, in case the flowers are bisexual, we have to remove the anthers from the female plant, isn't it? The anthers being removed, now the flower becomes pistillate, or it is going to bear only the female part. Now it will behave as a female parent. Right? And immediately after removal of anther, that is emasculation, you need to cover the emasculated flower with a butter paper or a polythene bag so that from outside some pollen grain should not inoculate the flower and cause cross-fertilization, isn't it? Cause cross-pollination should not take place, right? Next, what you need to do? You need to successfully and properly take some mature pollen grains and you have to dust it off near the stigma of the emasculated flower, and immediately again it has to be rebagged, right? So that you now are sure that the cross has been made between the two desired plant of yours, right? And then all you need to do is wait for the seeds to set. Alright, once the seeds will be formed, these seeds, out of the seeds, at least a few of them will show desired combination of characters in the hybrid, right? But then do remember, this step where you are simply, it might seem as if you are simply having to do emasculation and then bagging and that's it. It is a very simple strategy, isn't it? But this is actually not so. This step is a very, very tedious step. Why? Because first of all, you have to bring mature pollen grains and dust it off onto the stigma of the carpel. That is not going to be very easy. And the second step is that among thousands of seeds that will be born in the progeny after crossing these parental plants, you might get thousands of seeds. But out of those thousands, hardly one or two will be successfully combining the characters of the parents. Most of them will not combine. So to search for those one or two seeds would become a very tough and tedious job. Next, selection and testing of superior recombinants. Now, finally, among those particular hybrids that you have chosen with so much of difficulty, those hybrids are allowed to undergo self-pollination. Continuously, they are made to undergo self-pollination so that there is a kind of homozygosity, or you can say pure line. Those plants will now become pure line, and those characters that you have combined in the hybrid will not separate in the next generation. Finally, testing, release and commercialization of the new cultivar. Now see, after you have made pure line breeds from the hybrids, now next what you need to do is test them. Test them for their performance, for their, response towards irrigation or response towards fertilizer, etc. Many are things about how they would grow, under what condition they would grow well. All these things are to be tested, okay? Because finally, before allowing this particular new variety of crop to be produced in large scale, all the testings have to be done. Now, in India, this testing and evaluation is done by ICAR, Indian Council for Agricultural Research, New Delhi. Okay, so how the testing is done? First of all, this new variety or the new plant that you have created will be tested under in the research fields. Okay, under ICAR, there are many research fields that are present. All these hybrids would be first tested. In that testing, it would be seen how much irrigation responsivity, how much fertilizer responsive is it. Likewise, in what temperature it will grow well, or what are the moisture level required. So every other details evaluation will be done under the research field itself. Okay, so after it passes the research field, next it is then sent to be grown in the farmer's field for three successive growing seasons. And not only that, they are also grown in different parts of the country. Our country is divided into many agroclimatic zones. So in different agroclimatic zones, this particular newly improved variety of crop is tested. So first in the research field it is tested, then in the farmer's field for three successive growing seasons, it will be tested, that too in many different agroclimatic zones. Right. So after all this testing is done, if it is found to be suitable, finally this new variety of crop or the newly formed crop variety will be compared with the best available local crop cultivar. That means the best variety that already exists, that I already have, will be used as a reference, and it will be then used to compare with the newly improved variety that I have made. Okay.
So
even after that, if it passes this test, that means it is found to be much more better or much more, you know, improved in its quality in comparison to the best local cultivar. Only then its seeds will be produced in large scale, and it will be then certified and recommended by National Seed Corporation of India.
Okay.
It will be then recommended to the farmers to be grown in the next season. So this is how a new variety of crop is developed by a conventional method. Let me tell you the steps once again so that it becomes much more clear to you. First of all, when I'm trying to improve a crop variety, I'll have to go for its collection of germplasm. Germplasm means a collection of seeds or plants of all the different varieties of a species that has been formed so far. That means it will consist of the wild relative, and it will also consist of the most advanced variety that we have so far, and in between all the varieties. Okay, so all the different varieties of a species, so if the seeds of all the different variety of crops for a particular species of a plant, if collected, that collection of seed will be referred as germplasm. Understood that? So first thing that you need to do is germplasm collection. This germplasm collection forms the root or the backbone for any breeding program. Alright? Now, next, what you need to do, you have to choose among all those seeds. Okay? You have to make them grow into plants, and from among those plants, you have to choose two parental plants. Okay? Whatever is your desire, or whatever kind of new crop you are trying to make, accordingly you will choose the parent. After selection of the parent, for what you need to do is you have to mark one plant to be a male, another to be a female. Next, cross hybridization among the selected parents. Here you have to make the two plants, that is male and the female plant, undergo artificial hybridization by emasculation and bagging. This is going to be the most tedious part of all, because transferring the pollen grain successfully to the stigma is not a very easy job. And also, from all the different seeds that will be formed, among those seeds, say 1,000 of seeds, hardly one or two will be able to successfully combine the desired characters. Evaluating and finding out those seeds won't be that easy. Now, selection and testing of superior recombinant. So what you need to do finally, when you have found out that hybrid, you have to make it undergo self-pollination continuously so that you can produce a pure line breed. And finally, you have to make it go under a lot of testing, and that testing will be done by ICAR New Delhi. The first testing will be done under the research field, then it will be done in the farmer's field for at least 3 successive growing seasons and in different agroclimatic regions of our country. After that, finally, we'll have to compare the new variety with the best available local cultivar. Even after that, if it is found to be superior, only then large-scale production of the seeds of this variety or of this newly improved variety will be made by NSC, National Seed Corporation, and also they will release it and recommend it to the farmers to be grown in the next season. Alright? Now, let us discuss regarding Green Revolution. Okay? So, first of all, what is Green Revolution? See, India is mostly an agricultural country, and around 62% of India's population is employed under agriculture, right? So after India's independence, the main challenge that was faced by the country was to feed the growing population, because the agricultural plots were very limited, right? But the population was growing at a very explosive rate. So at such a situation, the only solution that we could come up with was increasing the per capita yield. Okay, that means in the same agricultural plot, if we could grow more amount or more quantity of crops, only then the growing demand for food could be properly settled. So it was around 1960 that this actually became possible. Okay, certain dwarf wheat and dwarf rice varieties were introduced in India, which were very high yielding. And because of that, because of the introduction of such crops, India's food production, it increased to a very large extent, to a great extent, all right? So this phase of growing high yielding varieties of crops in India, mainly rice and wheat, would be referred as Green Revolution. The period when not only we could meet our country's demand for food, but also we had surplus amount of grains that we could export to other countries. All right. So see here, the development of high yielding varieties of wheat and rice in the mid 1960s increased the yield per unit area. Okay. So this phase is called Green Revolution. This is the definition. All right. Now, during Green Revolution, to how much extent the increase in rice and wheat production will happen, you would be surprised to know that. See here, from 1960 to 2000, wheat production had increased from 11 million tons to 75 million tons. On the other hand, for rice, the production would increase from 35 million tons to 89.5, that means almost 90 million tons. Alright, so see the huge difference. 11 million tons became 75 million tons and 35 million tons became 89.5 million tons. Such a huge difference was brought to India. Alright, so now let us discuss a few important crops that had led to Green Revolution in India. First, dwarf wheat. Now, one important thing you should know here is that for Green Revolution to occur, mainly, certain dwarf wheat and rice varieties were introduced in India. These plants, they would not grow as much in height. That's why they are dwarf varieties. And they will channelize most of their resources in increasing their yield. Alright? So that's why they were very high yielding varieties. So see here, dwarf wheat. So first of all, for the production or formation of dwarf wheat by plant breeding, a gene called Norrin10 was reported in Japan. Now, Norrin10 would cause dwarfing in wheat. This gene, if introduced in the plant by plant breeding, that would make a plant dwarf. Alright? So, for a gene called Norrin10 was reported in Japan, which would cause dwarfing in wheat. Now, Norman E. Borlaug, Dr. Norman E. Borlaug, he is the person responsible for introducing this gene successfully to a wheat plant, which would create dwarf wheat varieties. So, Norman E. Borlaug at International Center for Wheat and Maize Improvement, Mexico, developed the semi-dwarf wheat by using this gene. Alright. Now, M. S. Swaminathan, he now collaborated with Dr. E. Borlaug. Okay. Dr. E. Borlaug, he produced this semi-dwarf variety of wheat, but then it was introduced in India by Dr. M. S. Swaminathan. Okay, Dr. M. S. Swaminathan is hence known as father of Green Revolution in India. But if it is asked who is the father of Green Revolution, not in India or any as such thing is not mentioned, only who is the father of Green Revolution, then your answer would be Dr. Norman E. Borlaug. Okay. M. S. Swaminathan, he collaborated with Dr. E. Borlaug and introduced this dwarf wheat varieties in India. Okay, so which were the varieties that were introduced? The name of the varieties were Sonora 64 and Lerma Roseau 64. But while they were introduced in India, M. S. Swaminathan, what he did is, he mutated these two dwarf varieties of wheat by gamma mutation mainly. He converted Sonora 64 into Sharbati Sonora and Lerma Roseau 64 by gamma mutation became Pusa Lerma. Okay? Sharbati Sonora and Pusa Lerma. What was the major difference? The major difference was in the color. Okay? So, Sonora 64 and Lerma Roseau 64, these were red-grained wheat, whereas by gamma mutation, Sharbati Sonora and Pusa Lerma, they became amber-grained, okay, amber-grained wheat varieties. So, introduction of these two finally had led to huge increase in the wheat production of India. Later on, further developed variety of wheat, much more higher yielding variety of wheat like Sonalika and Kalyan Sona were also introduced. By introduction of these high yielding varieties, the wheat production in India had reached a great height. Alright, so this was regarding the wheat production. Now, the next one would be dwarf rice. Now again, the same thing, first gene has to be isolated that could cause dwarfing in rice as well. So this time the gene that was, that can cause dwarfing in rice called DGOO gene was reported in Taiwan. Okay. Now, it was introduced in rice varieties by IRRI, that is International Rice Research Institute, Philippines, and in which of the plants? IR8, IR24. Alright. Now, the semi-dwarf rice varieties were derived from IR8 and Taichung Native 1, which was developed in Taiwan. Finally, these dwarf varieties, they were now introduced to India when they were introduced in around 1966. Alright. And later on, this high-yielding variety of rice were further developed and we got Jaya and Ratna variety of rice. Jaya and Ratna variety of rice had increased the rice production in India to a very large extent. Alright, so these two are very, very important, and this dwarf rice and wheat varieties were introduced to India were mainly responsible for Green Revolution. Okay. Apart from these two, there are another two types of crops that are also to be discussed and they are also important. First is sugarcane. Okay. Now see, regarding the production of sugarcane in India, there was a problem. The problem is that there is one species of sugarcane called Saccharum berberi. Saccharum berberi, it grows in North India. But it has thin stem, it has lower yield. That means basically it was not very, suitable a variety to be grown in the northern belts of India. Alright. On the other hand, we had another species of sugarcane, that is Saccharum officinarum, which grows in South Indian belt. Okay. That means in South India. And this particular sugarcane, it was very high yielding. It has thick stem, it had higher sugar content, and in short, it would be higher yielding. But the problem was that Saccharum officinarum, it could not be grown in the northern belts of India because of lower winter temperature. Alright. So in that case, in northern belts of India, the sugarcane production was not happening in an appropriate manner. So as a solution, what was done was this. Saccharum berberi and Saccharum officinarum, both of them were crossed. And by crossing them, a hybrid was produced. And this hybrid had all the good qualities that would be required for crop production. It was having higher sugar content, it would have thick stem, it would be high yielding, etc. So because of that, by plant breeding, when this hybrid variety was produced, it would increase the sugarcane production in India as well. So by plant breeding, so many alterations can be made in a plant genetically, which could make it very much desirable or very much useful to the mankind. Finally, millets. See, plants producing a large crop of small seeds would be known as millet. A large crop containing many seeds, that would be termed as a millet. Now, for example, jowar, bajra, maize, all of these are known as millets. Now, in India, various hybrid breeding high yielding varieties, which are resistant to water stress, which could grow even with less amount of water, so that irrigation cost can be reduced. Such varieties were also produced in India by plant breeding. And that would also lead to higher production of millets in India. So these are the important crops that were introduced in India, that were developed and made higher yielding. And that's how the food crops in India was enhanced. Alright, so this is a very important part of Green Revolution. All of you try to remember these names and the examples. Alright.